Hi. A year ago, I built this Jenga pistol, and I posted a video of it online on YouTube, and it's been viewed over 1.5 million times. So lots of people wanted to buy a Jenga pistol, so I experimented, and I came up with this Jenga pistol design, which I sold about 25 of online. But building lots of Jenga pistols really isn't my thing. I prefer to spend my time in the workshop inventing new things. But people still want Jenga pistols, so I've come up with an easier to build version, which is this one. And in this video, I'll show you how to build this one. It's also more powerful. The Jenga pistol plan is actually a series of templates that you basically paste on your pieces of wood, which means you don't really have to do much measuring. And there's also the one-to-one view of this. It all comes with the plans for the Jenga pistol, which you do have to buy for a few dollars, but if you just want to see how it's built, there's no charge on the video. It is a long video though, but enjoy. So this is my prototype of the new version of the Jenga pistol, and it's lying right on top of a one-to-one printout of the plans. And another page of the plans, which is very cool, is this, because this contains basically face-on views of all the different components. So for example, this trigger here is this, and this is the trigger head-on, and here's the handle. So we have all the pieces of the Jenga pistol just kind of laid out flat that we can use as templates for cutting it out. Now, to make this Jenga pistol, I'm going to need some wood, and this actually came out of an old desk. If you have to buy lumber, 3/4 inch thickness is sufficient. And the smallest piece that they'll sell you at a lumber yard will also be enough. A piece that's, say, for instance, 2 feet wide by 3 inches, that's going to be enough. And then another thing that we need is we need a little bit of dowel. 5/16 is ideal. 1/4 inch will work as well, but the 5/16 is a bit more robust. That will form this pin here. And we want that to be fairly robust because it whacks the Jenga blocks pretty hard. So let's go ahead and do a few basic cuts to start cutting the blocks that we need for these plans. So because this is a fairly narrow piece of wood, let's see. I have enough length here for the long pieces on here. And then, yeah, I can cut the handle out of this. So the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to cut enough off to cut the handle on these blocks, and then I'll cut the rails. Now the rails need to be cut fairly narrow. The rails are, for instance, like this part here of the Jenga pistol. And if you use a standard insert that comes with a table saw like this one, it has a really big hole in here. And I've set the fence to be the right distance from the blade, but I only have a few millimeters worth of ledge on here for my insert. So if you have a standard insert on your table saw, you have to be very careful because your wood can potentially get sucked into here. It's not going to do much harm in the process of doing that, but it's kind of scary and you can have some kind of other accident, so be very careful. A much safer thing to do is to use a zero clearance insert. So if we take this out, and here we've got our handy dandy homemade zero clearance insert. And now if we put that fence in the right position, we have lots of support in here, so there's no risk of material getting sucked in there. So a zero clearance insert is really kind of a safety thing, so be cautious if you don't have one. I'm going to use a zero clearance insert just to be on the safe side. So I've got two strips cut of the right thickness. The top one needs to be not quite as wide, so I've got my fence set up for a rip cut to cut this one a bit narrower. So this is what we got left after cutting those two rails, and here's all the pieces that we need. So we can put the pistol handle on here. So let's start cutting some of these out so that we can use those to kind of lay things out. So here we've got the handle layout piece, and I'm just going to use a few dabs of tiny bit of dabs of wood glue on here just to stick it down. We can always scrape this off afterwards. A Yoo-hoo stick might be even better than this, but I'm just going to use the wood glue because that's what I got handy. So to cut it out, I'm going to use my 14-inch bandsaw. Any bandsaw will do, really. I personally like to use my homemade bandsaw at this point, but just so you don't think you have to build a bandsaw to build a Jenga pistol, I'm just going to use my store-bought 14-inch bandsaw. So this shape is the handle as seen straight from up here. Now, because the handle is curved back here, we can't actually glue it on there flat, and that'll mess up the dimensions a bit. But it doesn't matter, because we really only need to get the width of that slot right, so I'm actually going to cut it off right here and then just stick this on here. Now the next thing I want to do is I want to cut these slots in here. Now to do this very accurately, I have to make sure my block isn't tilted like this in any way, and that I have good support around the blade. Now, on a lot of cheap bandsaws, this insert here is not really flat and all that. This bandsaw was no exception, except I made a new insert out of aluminum. But if you want to make sure that the area around the blade is flat on a cheap bandsaw, it's best to just put another piece of wood on top of the saw, like this one here, and I've already cut a slot in here. And now, if I clamp this onto the table using a couple of spring clamps, I'll have a nice flat surface around the blade and I won't get any wobbling with my workpiece. So here's the scrap that wasn't my handle, so I'm going to use this to form the front of the Jenga pistol, and I'm going to rub a tiny bit of glue on here. The thinner it is, the quicker the paper sticks to it. And let's put this on here, and then we'll cut that out. Now, this is the front, and the rails have to fit in here like so. Now, right now, these fit in way too tight, so I left a little bit too much material there, and I'm going to have to cut just a tiny little bit off of there. You can still see the line on here. And I can cut a little bit off of there just by using the back of the blade as a guide, and then using the sides of the teeth just to graze along the line. So let's do this. So see, the back of the blade doesn't cut, and I'm going to use that to push the wood again. And I'm going to take off just a tiny invisible sliver to get the cut. It's better. Perfect. So let's do a fit check here. So this goes into here, and I've cut out a spacer that goes into here, and that goes on here, and that goes in here, and in here. So those two look nice and parallel. Now we next need to drill a hole into here, and there's also a notch we need to cut out. So this is the side view that goes onto here, and you can see the notch. That notch cuts out a piece of this part as well. So we're going to just cut those two together once we've glued it together. And the same with the hole that goes in here. We're going to drill that through both parts after we glue it together so that we get the alignment just perfect. So I've got just a cheap little drill press here that I'm going to use to drill this hole. And to get this hole exactly on the crosshair, it helps if I put a divot in the middle of the crosshair, which I can do just with a awl to put that right in the crosshair and give that a good push. Helps even to tap it in with a hammer. And that puts a little divot in there, which helps the tip of the drill actually guide it into the middle of the hole. Now we want the hole on the back of this to have a tiny little bit of a sort of a funnel shape to it, and I'm going to use just a big X-Acto knife. Normally I use these German chipped carving knives, but a knife like this will do the job as well. And I'm going to cut this so that I'm going to have a bit of a funnel going there, sort of a bit of a chamfer around the edge. Now I could use a countersink bit and countersink that in a little bit. But the knife works pretty good too, and it leaves a cleaner cut. So now we can glue the bottom part of this Jenga pistol together. And I'm just going to use some ordinary wood glue. And I'm going to use a little wooden splint just to help me get the glue into here. Now, depending on how tight your fit is, you may need more or less glue. More glue is always good, it's just messy when it squeezes out of the sides. And let's squeeze that in here. See, we've got a bit of glue squeeze out here. And just for good measure, I'll clamp that together a bit. Now for the front, same kind of deal. Now, very important is this part that I've got this sort of funnel on here. That has to face the back. And let's put that on here, and that's good. So now I need to leave that alone for about 15 minutes. So while that is drying, I'm going to cut out this part here, which is the bolt that moves back and forth. This would be the end view of it here. And I'm going to put that upright on the bandsaw, so I need to get this cut really precise. So I'm going to cut this off on the table saw. Leave that on here for now. So let's cut that. So I'm going to cut this piece upright on here, so it's really important to have a very flat support, which I do with this piece of particle board that I've clamped onto my saw. And when I cut vertical like this, the blade runs along the grain of the wood, so it actually cuts kind of slow. Now this has to fit loosely on here, and right now, once again, I cut it too tight, so I'm gonna have to cut away a bit more. And now it slides quite freely. So this is the trigger piece for the Jenga pistol. It's the most complicated part. So I need to cut out this shape here, and then in the end, vertically, I have to cut this slot along like so. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to cut away this notch here and this part here first, so that I don't have to cut away quite as much when I'm cutting it like this. Now next I need to cut like this. Now to help me keep this block really vertical so it doesn't go like this, I'm going to take this piece of scrap wood and just attach it with the clamp here, and that will help me keep this thing nice and square so it's not going to tip side to side as I cut it. Now I've glued the side template thing on here, That tells me where I need to cut this notch. Next, I need to drill a hole in here, and I need to drill that 2 centimeters deep, so I've put a mark for how deep that goes, so that's to about here. So I remember how far I turned it, and I've already punched a little hole in the center of this to help me get the drill right in the middle of it, so let's drill that. I need to drill a hole in here for a dowel to go through here. I put a dowel in here for reinforcement because when the Jenga pistol shoots and it doesn't actually hit a block, this part really gets whacked. So I'm going to put a dowel through here just to make sure this joint is really solid so I don't end up breaking this joint on here. There's also a notch that needs to go into here. This is for the rubber bands for it to have a place. Otherwise, they might end up riding up and hitting the pin as it sticks out here. So let's cut that one. This little wooden splint, you could use a toothpick too if you want to. But I always find it important to get glue into the hole. And some glue onto the dowel as well. And let's carefully insert that. I've got a piece of dowel that goes into here. This is going to form the pin that actually hits the Jenga blocks. But before I glue it on there, I'm going to peel off this paper here because it's much easier to do that without that pin in place. Insert that in here, and we have to make sure it goes all the way down. Now the rubber bands have to stretch around this thing here, and a nice touch is to kind of chamfer this corner here, which actually this template sort of shows a little bit. So I'm going to take my knife, and I'm just going to carve away a little bit here. The next thing is we need to make sure we put this on here. We drill a hole in here to basically use this nail as a pivot. I get this in the right position. Let's make sure that actually catches. So we need a little bit of space back here. And we'll clamp it on here. But to make sure we have a little bit of room for this to move, I'm going to use these bits of paper here as a spacer so that it's not totally up against the other piece there, so it'll have room to pivot. And let's clamp that on here. So I've got a drill in here that'll give me a very tight fit with this nail. And let's drill that through both parts at the same time. Now the hole I just drilled is actually a little bit too small for this nail because I want that nail to be stuck in there, but I still want that trigger to turn loosely, so I want it to be a very tight fit on here but a loose fit on here. So I've just drilled both holes to make sure everything lines up, and now I'm going to move to a bigger size drill, just the next size up, and I'm going to drill through that hole again to make it bigger. So the nail is now fitting quite loosely in here. Now I need to cut that nail off so it doesn't stick out so much. Now I'm just going to mark it a little bit here. So we see a bit of a mark there, and I want to cut that nail a bit shorter because I don't actually want it to stick out on the other side. So maybe a millimeter less than what I just marked it at. And cut it off. Now I could stick that nail in here already, but before I do that, I'm going to take this thing and just round the corners a little bit all around, because that's much easier to do before we put it in there. Before I attach the trigger still, I'm going to make sure this all fits well. So this is a spacer block to keep that back rail in place. And this is the top rail. And we've got that in here, and this still slides very nicely, and that always hits the hole. So this looks like it's going to work. If this was a little bit too tight, you could still put that block on the bandsaw to cut a little bit off. Now the other thing is, precision is very important here. If I've got too much play on here, then this pin might not always hit this hole here, and it's going to waste a lot of energy kind of ricocheting off the edge. Or if it was really inaccurate, it might not even go through. Now we can finally attach our trigger using that nail pin. And I've got it in the hole here, and now it just taps in. And friction is basically what's holding it in. So there's our trigger. Now let's check. Yeah, that's good. Now the catch with this trigger is the tension actually pulls it open slightly. So we want that trigger to spring up a little bit, which is why we have this notch in here and a notch here. So I neglected to cut this notch earlier, but if I just hold it up on here, I can see that notch goes right about here. And I'm just going to put the whole Jenga pistol on the bandsaw to cut that out. Now, if we cross over the rubber band, like so, and then we hook it into here, and make sure that's on that side here, and that forms our spring-loaded trigger. Now, the Jenga pistol is almost ready. We just put this in here, and we put that on here. Now, the problem is, to get the rubber bands out, we have to actually remove this rail here, so we can't just glue it in place because these rubber bands will eventually wear out. So what we're going to do is we're going to put a couple of screws in, one here and one here, and that will hold that top rail in place. Now I'm going to use a slightly bigger drill so that I can make a bit of an indentation for the head of the screw. Now on this side, it's actually fairly thick, so I need to go a fair ways in because I really want to sink that screw below the surface so that it reaches over into the other piece as well. So do that. Not forget to put some rubber bands in here, otherwise this Jenga pistol is not going to shoot very hard. Another thing that you'll probably want to do with your Jenga pistol is just to take some reasonably coarse sandpaper and just kind of go over all the corners, because that makes the Jenga pistol feel much nicer to the touch. And you'll probably be playing with a lot, so you might as well be comfortable holding it. And now we get to do the all-important testing of the Jenga pistol. Works. The thing about using a Jenga pistol is you have to be mindful of the recoil, which tends to shift the position of the gun as it shoots. So if I just use it one-handed and I aim at the dark colored block here, I actually end up shooting the top block because the recoil just moves it up. So if I firmly hold it like this so that the Jenga pistol can't move up, then I won't have this problem. So I hope you enjoyed this video about building the Jenga pistol. And I'm sure if you build one, you'll have as much fun with it as I did. So go have a look at the plans, and it's really not that hard to build.